there's something that you don't know about dice. It's a strange thing, but a die, you know, is supposed to have, it has two on this side, and it has four on that side. Now, that's not the way it's supposed to be made. See, the four on that side and the two on that side, actually, it's supposed to be a five on that side, but it's not. This is not made properly. Two on that side, four on that side, two on that side, and five on that side.
How'd you do that?
I am the amazing Rudolph, and I will show you how easily a skilled magician can reproduce any of these so-called psychic tricks.
Hi, I'm James Randi. I'm a magician. That is to say, I'm a fake. Watch this. I'm going to do a little trick for you. I'm going to bounce this pen on the edge of the table. Now, I'll look away so you're sure I'm not blowing, but I want you to look right into your TV set, concentrate on it, make that pen fall off the table. Let's work on it now. Come on, concentrate. Stronger. Gee, that was very good. How did you do that?
June 7th, we'll be offering $100,000 prize to anyone who can prove psychic
we
powers
can do it.
On our program.
You're thinking of a pizza, right?
No.
A small little rodent? Maybe a hat? A hat?
No.
A clothespin?
No, wrong.
A shoe?
Gesundheit.
A hammer?
No.
We're going to get that money. We're going to make that money. We're going to make that money. We're going to get your money, Randi. You're going to be broke, man.
Do you believe everything you see on the news? How about a nationally reported story about a computer that determines the guilt or innocence of suspected criminals? Host James Randi, professional skeptic and a bunker of frauds, takes us through the conception, the setup, and the payoff of these remarkable scams.
I'm James Randi, and in this special presentation, we'll look at the inner workings of some of history's most outrageous scams and the confidence men behind them. Now, most cons follow a very simple set of rules. The first rule is that the con artist always wins.
Tonight on Nova, James Randi, magician and investigator of psychic phenomena.
Don't laugh, this is science.
For 25 years, Randi has explored the world of the paranormal and tested claims of supernatural powers.
Jesus.
Now, Randi journeys to Russia to challenge psychics never before seen in the West. After decades of research, can we finally discover the secrets of the psychics?
Throw them up there on the stage. You don't have to leave with those pills.
He had people who were on medication, necessary medication, like nitroglycerin tablets for heart attacks, digitalis, things like oral insulin. He had them come out of the audience and throw their pills up on stage.
Throw them up there. That's a blow of defeat for the devil.
As you see it, this is the real danger in all the faith healing.
It's one of the real dangers. The other danger is emotional dependence on charlatans like this, people who claim that they have an ability to tell you how to run your life and how to recover from disease.
Somebody praise him!
This week, Horizon is doing something completely different. For the first time, we are conducting our own experiment. We are testing a form of medicine which could transform the world. Should the results be positive, this man will have to give us $1 million.
Do the tests, prove that it works, and win $1 million.
Can psychics really sense what you can? Can the stars predict your future? And thousands of nurses say their touch can heal.
I'll give them $1 million if they can prove that.
Tonight, the supernatural, exposed by an expert on the bizarre.
Randi and his foundation have put up $1 million as a prize.
Oh, this is the one in Finland.
To anyone who could prove they have paranormal abilities. $1 million. It's in the bank. We check.
If they say they can defy gravity, step over to the window there and step out. And if you don't fall, hey, you win. You win.
Oh,
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I must tell you that I have to disappoint you to a certain extent. And some of you will be disappointed, others not so. I will not be doing my naked dance on fire. No, well, I found recently there's not much call for it, frankly. But we never know. It may come back, you know. They may recognize my skill in that particular artist. But boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, all ages, you see before you here a very mature gentleman who increasingly and truly admires sunrises somewhat more than sunsets. Though, of course, both phenomena are very interesting and beautiful. I travel internationally, espousing the fictions of paranormal and supernatural claims, and the happy circumstances that nonetheless allow us all to somehow survive together. Yes, it's a constant confrontation, a skirmish in need of careful attention, wise shaping and molding, and often rude interruptions. Oh, I advertise myself as a magician, but a better label is the word illusionist, meaning one who approximates what is real and what a magician who is really a magician could do. Perform miracles, in other words, if he or she could do that. Now, in order to prove that I have some right to the title, aside from what you've seen on video so many times, I'm sure, I should like to invite two gentlemen to join me on the stage here, two large gentlemen. There's one right there, a man with a beard, can't be all that bad. And there's another one right over there. Yes, join us up on the stage, you would be so kind. Let's have a round of applause as they... Very good. How do you do, sir? Yes, sir? And you, sir?
Patrick McCann.
That's a beard almost.
Almost, yes. Okay. Keep working on it.
It's hoping on it.
I'm jealous.
Yes. These two gentlemen are going to help me to demonstrate. Let's step over to this side of the stage here. Don't fall off. I'll try not to as well. Come a little closer, please. Now, I'm going to do a demonstration with these gentlemen. Do you happen, I forgot to ask, do you happen to have a piece of rope about that long? No? No? Neither? Oh, well, by a somewhat contrived coincidence, I admit that I do. And here it is, ladies and gentlemen, emerging from underneath my shirt. And this is a strong piece of rope. Hold on to that answer. That is your end. Both hands.
Yes, sir.
Both hands. Okay. Now, I want you to pull on the rope to make sure that it's quite secure. It doesn't come apart, unscrew, or anything like that. Okay? You satisfied?
Yes, sir.
Say yes.
Yes.
Okay. You let go now. It's my rope, after all. Now, I'm going to ask these two gentlemen, as I said, to tie my hands together, one on top of the other, in such a way that it should be impossible for me to release myself. Wink. Okay. All right. Now, hold on to your end, please. This is your end right there. Thank you. And you hold on to your end. And pull on it very tightly. I'll turn my body away slightly. All right. Pull on it now. Come on. Both hands. You're not using both hands. Okay. Okay. Keep it down there. Okay. Now, I'm going to put my other hand on top. I want you to tie my other hand on top, please. That's it. Pull on the knot very tightly. Make sure that it's quite firm. All right. And put your finger on the knot. All right. You got a knot? Tie another knot on top of that one. Oh, very good. Pull on it very tightly now. Is there room for another knot? Damn. Okay. Try another knot on top then, if it'd be so kind. Yeah, that is tight. Okay. Okay, that's it. Thank you. Don't break the arm too badly, okay? Now, I'm going to try to extricate myself. Don't stand too edge. Stand the edge here. Stand a little. Oh. The rope seems to have fallen off, ladies and gentlemen. How about a big round of applause for the rope? Thank you very much, sir. And thank you very much. Thank you. You can return to the audience. Now, these little demonstrations sort of indicate that perhaps I have some very strange sort of skill. But more seriously, at this conference, I want to say I am a very confirmed and serious atheist. Thank you. I think I can have a certain amount of trepidation that the present administration in Washington, D.C., might decide to have me classified as dangerous, since someone who will not swear on the Bible or to denies the existence of ghosts and angels, eternal life, relatives of God, etc., can surely be put on their list of persons who should be pushed back across the U.S. border into any other convenient country. And I'm sure that that thought is passing through the minds of some persons, unfortunately, in Washington, D.C. Now, I don't deny the possibility of anything classified supernatural. I can't do that, simply because I cannot prove a negative. If I were to say there are no unicorns in South America or South Africa, for example, I should be able to prove that statement. But I cannot. I can, I believe, give very good reasons for my disbelief in unicorns, but the burden of proof of the existence of these beasts should, and it does, confound those who try to do so. Unlikely? Yes, they're very unlikely, I believe. I can certainly give many reasons for that opinion, but proof? No. But when something is stated over and over again, as in Bible thumping, we've all heard a good deal of that, it can get through to people who don't think very much about it as if it were actual fact. That's a sad fact in itself. I know you've heard all this before, but I cannot claim that I have a solution to this situation. I'm seeking it, yes, we all are. However, I do have a one-word answer that requires a bit of explaining. That one word, ladies and gentlemen, is Dachau. It's the name of a concentration camp in Germany. I once made a visit to Dachau. It was quite an experience. I walked up the railway tracks along which the trains went that brought thousands and thousands of Jews to their final end in the concentration camps. I could have gone to Belsen, but I chose to go to Dachau. It was convenient for me to do so. But I didn't go on the tour, actually. I waited outside on one of the metal benches they have there for people who declined to actually go inside and have the tour. But those tracks guided the trains that led those people to their eventual demise. Through starvation, through torture, through gas, whatever it was, they died by the thousands. And so when people preach to me, and I get it all the time, you get it all the time too, I'm sure, that God is merciful, lives in the sky someplace, we all guess, merciful and will respond to prayer. I have an answer for that. I got it from Penn and Teller. Bullshit. So the next time somebody tells you how merciful and powerful God is, that's the answer to give them. I highly recommend it. And Penn and Teller didn't invent it, by the way. I knew it long before they did. Now, I've been to the White House, I proudly say, by invitation on two occasions. And I'll tell you that my second such experience occurred in November of 1974 during the Ford administration. You see, I was asked to entertain the children of the Washington diplomats at a pre-Christmas party that year. I was laying out my props for the magic show in the Blue Room. I prefer to use the Blue Room when I go to the White House. Yeah. When First Lady Betty Ford entered, flanked by two fierce-looking Secret Service officers. I boldly approached Mrs. Ford, thereby attracting the immediate attention of those Secret Service attendants, and I asked her if she would participate in my show, peripherally, in my act, by offering me a small red silk handkerchief, which I'd provided to her when I asked for it. Well, this evoked a comment from one of the Secret Service officers, whose name I believe was Frank, and he told me firmly that was out of the question. Really? Well, our First Lady, however, took the handkerchief from me with the comment and a glare over at Frank, and I quote, "I'd be honored to wear your colors, Mr. Randi," and Betty Ford tucked the small handkerchief into her belt. Damn. I swear I must have busted a shirt button or two at that very moment. The First Lady of the United States of America was acting as my assistant. Wow. Now, Christopher Hitchens is the name to conjure with. I'm sure we all know it. Yes, let's hear it. Please. I knew Chris Hitchens rather well. And I'm sure that most of us in this room have heard him, if not once, maybe many more times. But I was recently reminded of a couple of quotations from Hitchens that if you haven't heard them specifically, you should. And they're in his writings. One of them is this: "Organized religion is violent, irrational, intolerant, allied to racism, tribalism, and bigotry, invested in ignorance and hostile to free inquiry, contemptuous of women, and coercive towards children." Damn, I wish I had spoken those words. It's true. But here is a much more concise comment from Hitchens, and he said, by the way, you never called him Chris. He didn't want to be identified with the wrong person. He called himself Christopher. That was his name. He was given that name, Christopher. "Everything about Christianity is contained in the pathetic image of," begin quotes, "the flock," close quotes. Think about that, folks. I don't want to be a sheep. I don't want to be a lamb. I don't want to be somebody who's going to be taken to an abattoir eventually after they take off all my wool, maybe several times before I'm taken off to my final end. I don't want to be somebody in a flock of sheep. We should not accept that terminology. It's ridiculous, and it's a terrible, terrible insult to all of us. So next time you hear a minister talk about the flock, just do a bah. It might work. But I must say that Chris's respect for women and respect for the atheistic point of view outlived him a great deal. When he went, I was very heavily affected by that. But I must say, I also have a souvenir. He was sitting on a folding chair in front of a huge warehouse door. I don't know exactly what the location was, but I was doing some sort of thing out front, and I had to circle around the back of the stage, and I had my camera around my neck, and I clicked a picture of Hitchens sitting there. There was a sign beside him in letters almost as big as he was: "Do not sit in front of this door." And he sat there like this. No question of it. What a character, what a fine man. And unfortunately, we lost him very prematurely. Now, I have found, unfortunately, that the American public's understanding of science is rather weak. A large percentage of those who regularly scoff at the progress science has made would simply not be here if it were not for advances in our understanding of the world around us. And I am a perfect example, I'm not perfect, I'm an excellent example of that fact. I've had more operations than I can count. And that is exactly what science is all about. Science is part of our survival mechanism, it works and it can be shown to actually work. Those quacks and scam artists out there do not have a record of success and leave behind them broken hearts, crippled bodies, and shattered dreams. Always remember that picture, please. Recent National Science Foundation surveys show that though a great number of Americans support scientific research and government sponsorship of the same, half of those surveyed are unable to answer fundamental science questions about the world around them. Historically, there has been a close relationship among perception, misperception based on apparent reality, and scientific knowledge derived by critical analysis. Education is critical thinking. Investigating why we think what we do trains students to examine the gaps and inconsistencies in their knowledge base and to more accurately separate fact from fallacy and fantasy. The U.S. Patent Office at one time issued patents only after a working model of a proposed device or system had been produced. Regularly today, plans for perpetual motion machines, free energy machines, cheap and easy counterfeit money detectors, control systems triggered by thought waves, and devices that find drugs, guns, minerals, and oil are received at that office. Are working examples still required by the office? Oh no, not now. No, we made a shortcut here. Now it seems that all it is needed is for a master of some kind to look over the application and to rubber stamp it. They don't demand a working model. This is a great weakness in our patent system. Great weakness. Now, I hold in my hand here a device that many of you will have run into when you tried to spend a $50 or a $100 bill. It's called the counterfeit detector pen. Sounds wonderful, doesn't it? The makers claim that a phony bill stroked by this pen will register a black line, while a genuine bill will show an amber-colored line. Really, it bears patent, U.S. patent number 5,063,163, so it must be the real thing, right? The patent examiner who approved this patent read somewhere that counterfeiters use cheap, recycled paper which has starch content. And since this is an iodine pen, tincture of iodine, that's all it is, the cheap paper would turn black, as starch does when in contact with iodine. Now, let's do a little demonstration. Do I have a piece of regular notepaper down there? I think I probably have that'll do it, okay. Thank you very much. Come over here to witness this, if you would be so kind, step up on the stage. This is the counterfeit detector pen. Ooh. Watch this. What color would you say that is, sir?
Black.
Black. Oh. Thank you very much. You can take a piece of paper and go back to the audience. A big round of applause for the gentleman, please. Okay. Folks, do you really think that a counterfeiter would use cheap paper to print on to convert a piece of ordinary paper into a $100 bill? I think they could go for 20 cents or so to get some paper that wouldn't do that. Well, this pen makes a lot of folks very, very happy, though, I must tell you. First, we have those who sell the pen. Oh, they're very, very happy. And hundreds of thousands in major office supply houses all over the USA and Canada are also happy with it. Second, even happier, are the counterfeiters themselves. Don't you think? Whose product will go right back into circulation and continue on to deceive people as it passes around. And we pay for this. By this means, we allow some hundreds of billions of dollars in bogus bills to circulate freely, since countless restaurants, stores, and other businesses in this country use this useless pen to decide whether or not they should accept the currency. Well, I'm all for simple experimentation. I always have been. And I have here in my wallet, someplace here, wait, I have a wallet, there we are. I knew I had you. And I have, let me see, where, in here some, yeah, there we are. I have here, can I have that gentleman up here again, would you mind, sir? And here's the pen, thank you very much. You're doing double duty today. I want you on the white part of this bill here, would you make a stroke with the pen, please? Whoops. All right. Now, what color does that, it's very hard to see the color there.
Yellow.
Sort of yellow-brown.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much, sir. Another round of applause, please, gentlemen. Don't overdo it, don't overdo it. Now, folks, that shows that this bill is genuine, you see, because it made just a light brown, sort of coffee-colored stain. But look at this. This bill was made on a copy machine, a Xerox machine, and it was just simply copied by pressing a button and room. In fact, I made five or six of them for future lectures, you see, that are coming up in Europe. But this was made on a copy machine. That bill detector pen just simply does not work. It's a total phony. But according to the instructions, it does work. Well, wait a minute. I guess we don't really need this, do we, anymore? I'm tearing up a $100 bill. Oh, shock, shock, shock. Shock and trepidation. All right. Go away, phony bill. Ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to believe that we're sophisticated and aware and that we can't be fooled easily. But we're human beings with all the failings of our species. Customs agents, police officers, legislators, patent examiners, even science and scientists, pardon me, and technicians are all subject to bad judgment from time to time. It's inevitable. But much of that weakness can be avoided by education at an early age. I'm talking about children now, adolescents particularly. Our philosophy can be taught to people at that age. We owe it to our kids to inform them and train them how to think, not what to think. In many ways, we've failed this generation. Let's not allow ourselves to be taken advantage of anymore. We can and we must oppose those who would cheat us. In my work now, and I'm 89 now, going on 100, I say it that way because it sort of encourages me. So I'm fooling myself, I guess. But hey, all of my grandparents, all four of them, they had, that's the usual number, all four of them lived into their late 80s and two of them into their 90s. So I'm sort of encouraged. I think that's not false ambition or anything like that. That's a good indication of the fact that I probably have the ability to live a long, long life, much longer than this. And if I hit 100, let's call another meeting, shall we? In my work, I've seen firsthand the ravages of superstition and misinformation. It's appalling, I can tell you. Kids who have checked out of reality and adopted fantasies other than facts. Adults who have abandoned any efforts at improving themselves and want to hire gurus to run and often to ruin their lives. Now, one of the reasons that the general public tends to believe in these things, this nonsense, is parapsychology. Parapsychology was come up with by a gentleman named Ryan many years ago, and he was completely self-deceived. He published several books on it and how he had tested some people that actually failed to pass the test, but he never mentioned the names of the people who had failed the test, but everyone who appeared to pass the test, oh, he gave them pictures in his books and whatnot, photographs of them working his wonders. So come on now. And what did they use for this? Well, ESP cards are one of the things that they used, and I have a deck of them right here buried in my chest someplace. There we are. This is a deck of ESP cards, so-called. They're also known as the Zener cards. They were invented by a psychologist named Zener. And it consists of five different symbols. The circle, plus mark, the wavy lines, square, star, and it repeats all over again. There are five of each of them, and here a deck of 25 cards. Well, I'd be willing to believe that these were pretty safe. They look like it to me. Because when I show you, I mean, come on, you can't tell what that card is on the other side. It's a circle. There you go. You can't tell, can you? But look at this demonstration. Now, there's the circle. There's the circle. See? I think you could have guessed if I'd had a flashlight in my pocket. There we go. Look at this. You can clearly see that this is a circle on this side of the card. They are not made properly, and they can easily be made properly. Now, we all know the expression, the bicycle playing card. It's a company, the US Playing Card Company, and those playing cards are made with three layers of paper. The first layer of paper is the one that the symbol, whatever it is, ace, king, queen, etc. On one side, that's one layer of paper. That is laminated with another layer of paper, which is absolutely opaque. It's black, thin paper with a metallic layer in there. You cannot see through it, no matter what you use. And on the other side is the back of the card. Each one of those playing cards is a lamination. That's how the US Playing Card Company and so many other playing card companies all around the world make their cards absolutely foolproof. It's important to know that the playing card company can make them, while the people who make the so-called ESP card decks can't make them. Now, I must say that my personal heroes are few, but very large. Carl Sagan was a good friend. Isaac Asimov was close to me in many ways. Martin Gardner was a minor god of mine, pardon the expression. He'd be very embarrassed to hear that, so I'm just kidding. Richard Feynman and I, a great scientist, exchanged many useful thoughts. And Richard Dawkins has supported me and the James Randi Educational Foundation in many ways over the years, but heroes like that should be far more abundant. Now, lest you get any notion that this dependence upon nonsense is new to us, let me read you a quotation. Oh, by the way, the term quack is derived from the German word quacksalver, which means a person who is doing phony things, doing frauds of various kinds. So that's where the word quack came from. Quack, 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 you know, people like that. This is the quotation. Heroes have gone out. Quacks have come in. The reign of quacks has not ended with the 19th century. The scepter is held with a firmer grasp. The empire has a wider boundary. We are all the slaves of quackery in one shape or another. One portion of our being is always playing the successful quack to the other. These words were spoken by Thomas Carlyle, a prominent philosopher and historian, in the year 1881, 118 years ago. It's been around for a long time, folks. We are, it seems, reliving a bad aspect of our own history. We should learn from that and put an end to it. Before I leave you, I must introduce you to a young lady who's in the audience. I approached this young lady at the back of the room. I made sure that no one was speaking over her shoulder, and said she sat well away from everybody else. And I sat with my back turned to her, and I asked her to do me a favor. That young lady is in the audience tonight, this afternoon, pardon me. Where are you, young lady?
Here.
There you are. Okay, fine. You can stay right where you are. What is your name again, please?
Lindsay.
Lindsay. Yes, I'm sorry, Lindsay. I forgot it. Lindsay, I'm going to tell the audience here what we did just before. We're on that same position, as a matter of fact, there. I turned my back on you, and I presented you with something that you didn't expect to be given. It's a real estate book. I got this in Florida, I must admit. They give them out in the street that easily. And how many pages, do you remember how many pages were in it? More than 250, I believe. Yeah, more than 250 pages in the book. And I sat you down at the table, and then I walked away, and I turned my back, and I spoke to you over my shoulder. And I asked you if you would be kind enough to turn to any page, and I've forgotten what page you turned to, but you turned to one of the pages. You selected it at random. We had to look at a couple of pages, because some of them were pages with big ads on them. They didn't have many words, but we chose one that had a dense massive words there, right? And I asked you, now I was facing away from you, sitting at another table, no one was speaking over your shoulder, and I asked you to simply close your eyes and run your finger around on the page and stop any place at all. And I asked you, when you stop there, if it's a word like and or but, don't choose those words, they're very, very commonly seen, but choose another word there that's somewhat bigger perhaps. And you did that, did you? Okay. And nobody was looking over your shoulder now, and you didn't tell anybody, right? Okay. I'm going to step over to the board here, and I'm going to start guessing. That's a lie. Nothing has been arranged between Lindsay and myself, except that what I recited to is exactly what she did. I'm going to face away and not pick up. I've got a light in my eyes here anyway, so I can't quite see you if you change your expression or go, or something like that. It may be right or wrong. You can never tell. But please don't. You didn't tell anybody, Lindsay, I must check this for you. You didn't tell anybody what the word was, right? Didn't discuss it with anyone at all. Okay. This is going to be a little harder than I thought, but. All right, I'll step over here. Just think of it. I did that on purpose. And I think my microphone has failed, has it? No. Is it still? Can you still hear me out there? Okay, all right. I'll speak up a bit too, anyway. Now I'm going to step to the board here, and I have stepped to the board. I'm going to start to draw. No comments from Lindsay or anyone else, please. Wow, this is a strange word. This is peculiar. Lindsay, this is not a combination of numbers and letters, is it? Because I don't get this. This doesn't. I get an 8. That can't make any sense at all. All right. And I get this is very, very strange. I get sort of a bracket here, like that. Well, this is not exactly what I was hoping for.
But wow. No, this does not make any sense to me at all. No, that's wrong. There, that's, but it still doesn't make any sense to me. Well, Lindsay, I have to ask you, I have to surrender, unfortunately. What was the word that you chose at random just by running your finger around on the page? Pardon?
Package.
I've done it again. I got it upside down. I've done that before, you know. Lindsay, thank you very much. Thank you so much for your participation. That is an example, ladies and gentlemen, of what we magicians, conjurers is a much better word, what we magicians call mentalism. It appears to be done with the mind only, without any cheating. Oh, I cheated. You bet I did. In order to get that, and in order to do any of the tricks that you've seen here this evening. But I must say this, it's been a true delight to meet all of you and to share my observations with you. I'm told that we will now have a very short intermission followed by a Q&A period. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your kind attention. Thank you. Thank you so much.